Hello everyone. On behalf of Sancheti Hospital, I welcome you all in yet another webinar wherein we are going to discuss current trends in spine rehabilitation. Before diving right into today's topic, I'll quickly introduce myself. My name is Dr. Purva. I'm a spine physiotherapist at Sancheti Hospital. I hold a master's degree in musculoskeletal sciences. My practice and expertise extend to manual therapy, neural mobilization, and kinesiotaping. For today's webinar, I'd like to introduce a special guest, Dr. Siddharth Iyer. Dr. Siddharth Iyer is a consultant spine surgeon at Sancheti Hospital. Sir has completed his postgraduate degree in orthopedics. His expertise involves minimally invasive small incision spine surgeries involving extreme and lateral interbody fusion and minimally invasive T-lift from Singapore. He also holds a fellowship in pediatric spinal pathology from Hong Kong and is a recipient of Scoliosis Research Society, SRS, Asia. His expertise also involves spinal deformity correction, spinal infections, and spinal trauma management. We welcome you, sir. Dr. Siddharth Iyer will be introducing two important topics associated with this panel discussion today. Sir, I request you to throw a light on this topic and share your views.
Okay. Thank you, Purva, for that introduction. I'll be sharing my screen now. So in today's session, we'll briefly go through the clinical features and the management of two very common disorders that we see in everyday practice. One of them is lumbar disc herniations, and the other one is lumbar canal stenosis. So what's common to both these conditions are they are in the very essence of the term nerve root dysfunctions, where you have a nerve root dysfunction due to some sort of compression, which may be mechanical. Quite often, there is an associated biochemical inflammation on that nerve root, along with the compression. And predominantly, the patient comes to us for what appears to be leg pain or leg symptoms, which may be in the form of a sciatica or radiculopathy, or they may have something that's more chronic in nature, such as a neurogenic claudication that limits their standing and walking tolerance. Both of these have the degenerative disc disease as the front runner, and at some level, the degeneration is what leads to the formation of these two pathological conditions. So there you have it. You have a normal spine. That disc can degenerate and cause a focal compression with a prolapse or an extrusion or a sequestration, and then causes what we call clinically as a lumbar disc herniation. And over a period of years with the degeneration of the disc, there is a chronic lumbar canal stenosis, which is the end result, and the patient comes with claudication. So for both these conditions, in terms of assessment and deciding the plan of management, I think indispensable is still the medical history. It's quite often said a doctor who cannot take a good history and a patient who cannot give a good history are both in danger of giving and receiving bad treatments. And this is very much true for lumbar disc herniations and also for lumbar canal stenosis. So if you look at basically why the lumbar disc herniates, there are two postulated mechanisms. One is an annular tear. So there is a tear in the annulus fibrosis, and under gravity loading positions, a part of the nucleus pulposus or its content is herniated on the posteriorly located cauda equina or the nerve roots. Occasionally, you can have end plate breaks where the hairline cartilage avulses off from the subchondral bone, and along with it brings a sizable portion of the annulus and the disc material, and thereby causes compression in the lumbar spine. So the main diagnosis for both these conditions is on symptomatology. So the diagnosis is not on the MRI, but it's on the symptoms, because we know that the asymptomatic MRI is very common. Canal stenosis, but it often does not need treatment because the patients may still remain asymptomatic. If you just go on the MRI diagnosis of these two conditions, you're likely to make mistakes in both the diagnosis and the management. So broadly speaking, if you look at MRIs, after every 10 years post 30, there is likelihood that you will get asymptomatic findings such as disc prolapses, disc bulges on the MRI somewhere. So much so that if you look at any patients above the age of 50 or 60, maybe 30 to 40% of these patients may have some amount thought to be in the spectrum of lumbar disc herniations and lumbar canal stenosis. So the symptomatology is the clue to the diagnosis, and it's all on diagnosis on history. So quite often lumbar disc herniations come for acute low back pain, may or may not be relating to any trauma. The main symptom they have is radicular pain, that is sciatica. So they have pain that radiates from the buttocks or all the way down to the lower limb in a dermatomal distribution, depending on the nerve root that is compressed most. They may have associated weakness in the myotome that's supplied by that nerve root. Clinically, often if you see these patients, they may have a sciatic list and they have reduction in their ability to stand and walk due to the pain. A less frequent presentation would be that of cauda equina syndrome, where a very large central disc herniation has occurred and it causes deficit involving multiple nerve roots in the cauda equina, quite often with bowel bladder symptoms and saddle anesthesia, and which is actually a medical emergency which needs urgent surgical decompression and discectomy. So if you look at features quickly, list, sciatic list, range of movements are restricted in these patients. The key to confirming the diagnosis on the examination is to establish nerve root tension signs. So you do perform a passive straight leg raising test, which may be positive. You also look for LASIK sign, which is aggravation of the pain after dorsiflexion of the foot. You would want to assess your myotomal weakness to make sure that you're not looking at a significant. A brief history here now is mandated with regards to Waddell's criteria or yellow flags. So low back pain is quite often associated with psychosomatic complaint indication issues. So you must do a good history taking in terms of Waddell's criteria and yellow flags to rule out these scenarios, because you don't want to be or who has Waddell's criteria positive. So on the examination, if you look at evidence that supports a good weakness in a myotome or a sensory testing which shows hypoesthesia in a given dermatome, the SLR is a gold standard. LASIX is very sensitive. Other symptoms that we often ask for is cough impulse, hyperextension, the femoral stretch test, or the range of motion. These do not correlate so well with the diagnosis, and they may give you a few teeth with a pinch of salt sometimes. So today's basic discussion I have framed on four very good articles that are looking into lumbar disc prolapse and their natural history and their treatment. And for any person who is interested in understanding lumbar disc herniation, I would definitely suggest these four disc prolapse behaves. And from these four articles, there are four points that I'd like to share with you. One is lumbar disc herniations have a very fatal pain, is treated with conservative management and can improve in up to 80% cases. Occasionally, you may have recurrent sciatica, which may be bothers, improves in about 80% with conservative treatment. The surgical outcomes are generally better in the first 2 years, and then eventually, if you follow up both surgical and follow-up after 5 years, that improvements tend to plateau off. So on the whole, conservative treatment does appear to be appropriate for mild to moderate symptoms. Surgical treatment is generally reserved for patients who present with, you know, failed conservative management or who have significant progressive neurological deficit or a cauda equina, in which case surgery is the only and the suitable treatment option. So then coming to the examination, you noted the positive findings of the nerve root tension sign. Then you recommend the patient to get an MRI. It's the investigation of choice to diagnose a lumbar disc herniation. The MRI should be correlated with the myotomal weakness matching to confirm whether the MRI is actually picked up the symptomatic disc. occasionally we do need x-rays also sometimes to rule out lysis or concomitant instability. CT myelography may be, you know, patient with a pacemaker or patient who has other reasons for which MRI can't be done. The electrodiagnostic studies are generally supplementary and they are quite often used when there is diabetics, but as a primary investigative modality, it need not be used in every and all patient. So for example, an X-ray, you can see on the MRI a solisthesis, and then the X-ray is better suited to identify this solisthesis and instability. If you look at disc prolapses, there are prolapse in which there is a focal protrusion, but the disc material is still continuous with the parent disc. Extrusion where it's annulus fibrosis such that the disc is no longer contained like it is in the prolapse. So it's an uncontained version is an extrusion. And sequestration is when the portion of a disc fragment that ruptures or is no longer contained by the annulus fibrosis and then detaches itself from the parent disc to lie independent. These are basically the radiological types of disc herniations. So I will be briefly going through the conservative management. It will be dealt in detail. Candidate for conservative treatment is, you know, a patient who has a small disc fragment, a fairly large canal, a patient who does not have significant sciatic, patient who has underlying psychological or litigation issues are better suited for conservative management. Any patient where the clinical findings does not correlate, again a case where I would offer conservative treatment rather than surgical intervention. So quickly, one slide on Waddell's criteria. So you like yellow flags or any other underlying features that are such as litigation or workman's compensation. So any patient who has just even superficial palpation causes overt responses in terms of pain. Generally, you can axial load the spine by pressing on the head and then see whether the patient, you distract the patient in asking him some questions regarding his work or his house or where does he stay, and then do a sitting SLR to see whether the patient actually has nerve root weakness or the numbness does not match a dermatomal or a myotomal picture, then you have to accept that there may be an alternative diagnosis in pain. So pain completely out of proportion of what is seen on the MRI, again, is a Waddell's criteria and better suited for non-operative care. So towers, we give non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. We manage neuropathic pain with medications such as gabapentin, pregabalin. We offer the patient physical. And then sometimes if the pain is really severe, the patient can be undergoing pain management in the form of nerve root blocks or epidural steroids. These both serve severe pain. You give them a block. Therapeutically, their pain improves and they are feeling better. And diagnostically, because you block the L5 root in an L4-5 disc, L4-5 extruded disc was the pain generator in your case. And that is why it confirms the diagnosis that the symptoms are due to that disc. So you can use any form, interlaminar, transforaminal. They all have evidence to support that they are good for short-term benefit. However, sometimes they lack of response, after which the patient develops symptoms later on. The gray area is in the dose, route, and frequency. So how many injections, how soon each injection. These are quite often not confirmed or not accepted uniformly, but then on the whole, the epidural to acute onset lumbar disc herniations. So for example, you have a patient like this, L4-5 central disc herniation, and he has sciatic selective nerve root block, and the dye clearly outlines the exiting root and helps improve the pain responses for the patient. Last slide on surgical management. SET or quad equina are the two conditions that need surgical intervention. Occasionally, if the patient is non-responsive to conservative management after 4 to 6 weeks, then sometimes surgery may be offered. The gold standard for surgery is generally a microdiscectomy with newer technologies, endoscopic discectomies or tubular discectomies. But in the end result, they all aim to achieve what a microdiscectomy aims to achieve. That is, short about lumbar disc herniations. I will now proceed to lumbar canal stenosis and quickly go through those slides as well before I hand it over to Purva. Disc herniation. So here the combined effect of degeneration in the disc, facet and the phloem leads to a lumbar canal stenosis. Lumbar disc herniations, the offending agent is only the disc, but healing and causing problems in the patient. These end up resulting in reduction in the canal dimensions, and sometimes occasionally you get instability as well. The crux of the problem is you have a degenerative process. So it starts with a process of dysfunction. So you get synovitis in the joints, you get hypermobility. This dysfunction to stabilization, in which the instability, because it's worsened due to capsular laxity and subluxation, the body throws osteophytes to try and reduce the instability. The end result of these three processes, dysfunction, instability, and stabilization, is large osteophytic formation, phloem hypertrophy, facet hypertrophy, and all of, and thereby reducing its dimensions and causing lumbar canal stenosis. So again, like lumbar disc herniations, the diagnosis is on a urogenic claudication or radicular pain in a dermatomal pattern is the key. You need to know what is the claudication distance and time to assess how disabled the patient is. Especially in long-standing lumbar canal stenosis, where there's a very tight lumbar canal, you can get deficit. But normally, patients do not have weakness and they come predominantly for only. You have to exclude other causes of vascular claudication. So, you know, look for whether the pain is in the calf or in the proximal thigh. Is it distal to proximal? Is there associated trophic in the patients? So the diagnosis again for lumbar canal stenosis is MRI is the gold standard. X-rays are utilized to assess instability in the form of used only in select scenarios where you feel that there is either a coexisting neuropathy or sometimes a multi-level pathology and you want to assess which nerve root or So in X-rays, I think they are more important in regenerative lumbar canal stenosis rather than lumbar disc herniation, because there is quite often an co-flexion extension X-rays and dynamic X-rays to assess whether there's overt sagittal translation of more than 4 mm or if the angulation is more than 22 degrees. Lumbar canal stenosis can be treated with only a decompression or whether it needs so along with it a fusion. So if there is no instability on X-ray, quite, but if there is instability, often we have to consider the fusion as an option to reduce the chances of the instability progressing after the decompression. In three forms, you get either a central canal stenosis where the predominant area is in the midline. This is often due to the disc or the phloem. Zone of lumbar canal stenosis is the lateral recess, which is generally due to the facet hypertrophy or the osteophytes from the superior articular process. The medial most extent of canal stenosis. You can get a little bit of disc bulges on the paracentral regions, which can cause lateral recess stenosis. And the last to collapse in the disc height, which reduces foraminal disc foraminal height in the craniocaudal dimension. The osteophytes on those and also the disc osteophyte complex anteriorly can cause reduction in the canal dimensions. So for example, central canal stenosis, generally we look at the midline, but for foraminal narrowing, we look at the parasagittal cuts to see how stenotic the nerve root is. So you can compare this for quite tight here. Obviously here again, we look at some foraminal stenosis. We look at the mid-sagittal cuts to assess the central canal in some patients. There are in short three. You offer only decompression. You offer decompression and segmental fusion of that level. Or sometimes you have to do a long segment fusion where you access. Simply speaking, decompression only is only when the patient has leg pain, not much back pain, and there's not much instability on the radiographs. But if there is radiograph, pick whether you do the fusion through a posterior approach, anterior approach, that is all for surgeon's choice. Occasionally with the lumbar canal stenosis, you have spine deforms. In those cases, to address the deformity, you have to fuse him long or fix him long, in which case maybe you have to fuse multiple segments and not just the single segment. So what is the rationale of surgery? The main rationale of the surgery is we have to decompress the dural sac and the nerve root and remove the compression. What herniation, which may have to be removed, that is one offending factor. You can have osteophytes. So those need to be removed. So osteophytes like this, which compress the lateral recess. Sometimes you have large facet hypertrophies and the medial superior articular process is causing interest that. And last is by removing the ligamentum flavum, which is in the midline. It can cause both central and lateral recess stenosis, and that is removed like this. So in lumbar stenosis, the main aim is you address which are compressing the dural sac and nerve root and remove those offending factors to decompress the canal. If this process of decompression is liable to lead either preoperatively or intraoperatively to fuse that level, which means that that level is no longer mobile and is unlikely that instability will progress in the symptoms to the patients. So I'll just quickly go into my last slide. So ideal patient for decompression is predominantly leg pain, has neurogenic either on clinical examination or on radiology, and has good preserved, good range of movement. So that's symptomatology. That's the ideal patient for decompression. When we do the facet capsules and PARs so that the patient does not develop instability iatrogenically, what's the ideal patient for decompression and fusion? So patient who has also, he has a morning catch, he has instability catch on clinical examination, or has radiographs which show instability in which there is a spondylolisthesis or a translation. These again may sometimes end up needing fusion. So I thank you for a patient listening, and I hope that the nations and lumbar canal stenosis are cleared, and the reason we choose a particular form of surgical management is also clear. I will stop sharing my request, Purva, to take over for further procedure, further proceedings of this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for enlightening us today on a different clinical assessment. Surgical and conservative approaches in lumbar disc herniation and lumbar canal stenosis. You also highlighted on yellow flags associated with it. I think this information has been highly insightful for all of our viewers today. So without any further delay, I'll be taking this topic further on conservative management in physiotherapy rehabilitation. I'll share my screen now. Uh, Let's talk about the current trends in spine rehabilitation in the conservative manner. Like sir highlighted that PIVD and lumbar canal stenosis are conditions of grave concern. The clinical features are alarming and the pain could be excruciating and causes an hindrance to all the daily activities. So physiotherapy plays a pivotal role in conservative management here. So the main focus in conservative management would be spine stabilization and core recruitment. Restoring and improving spinal mobility, promoting healing of the deranged tissues, and decreasing pain would be the main goals. Clinically, pain is due to the underlying anatomical condition, paraspinal muscle spasm, hypomobility or loss of function, stiffness causes pain, muscular tightness blocks the movement, and there are certain radiculopathy, radicular symptoms, also called as neural symptoms, which are also seen clinically. So how do we manage or tackle these sequentially? First and foremost is pain and paraspinal muscle spasm. Cryotherapy is a very old and ancient way of tackling pain and spasm. Cryotherapy is based on Lewis-Hunting reaction, wherein there is a vasoconstriction followed by vasodilatation, which causes gushing of blood flow and increases circulation and helps in removal of toxins. Also, cryotherapy provides numbing effect and temporarily blocks pain at superficial levels. Electromodalities have been used for over two decades. They comprise of low frequency currents, laser therapy, heat modalities, superficial heat modalities. All of them work on one principle, that is blocking the pain gate at the spinal level. Apart from that, these are the modalities which could be used. Isometric exercises, which most of us give in an acute PIVD case or whenever patient is presenting with excruciating pain. The main goal in giving isometric exercises are to maintain muscle activity or maintain some mobility around the joint and promote blood circulation and maintain the spine in a neutral way without allowing the patient to do excessive movement. The next would be muscle release techniques. This is very important when we are dealing with muscle spasm. They are basically hands-on interactive technique providing stretching, compression, and sustained pressure to the connective tissue. This also improves the flexibility or sort of reduces its spasm and improves blood flow, thereby reduces the stiffening effect on the particular joint. Nowadays, the current trends are instrument-assisted MFR techniques, matrix therapy, scar tissue mobilization, wherein we are using different tools or instruments, and we are providing the same effect, that is muscle release. Next clinical feature we are focusing on is hypomobility. Now, in hypomobility, the main concern is to improve joint range of movement. How to do it? There is a concept called the McKenzie concept, which I'll be elaborating in the next slide. This provides accurate clinical diagnosis, and based on the diagnosis, we differentiate the syndromes and likewise treat them. And we assess different movement patterns, which are painful, and then we target the movement patterns. Either we are going in the direction of the painful movement pattern or we are going in the opposite direction. The goal is the same, to reduce the pain. The next very important is manual therapy. Manual therapy has different joint mobilization techniques, which basically helps in sliding or gliding the joints. And they target the arthrokinematic motion. Gentle oscillations reduce the stiffening of the surrounding connective tissue, capsular stiffness. and improve joint range of movement largely. The main or the important ones which we manual therapy techniques which we are currently using are Maitland and Mulliken approaches. And finally, it's core stabilization that provides good joint range of motion by giving stabilizing effect. The spine is surrounded by a corset of muscles, which are called as the core muscles. And they support the spine or sort of help in aligning in an erect posture and also give spine sort of mechanical stiffness. With low back pain or disc herniations or stenosis, these muscles become inefficient, thereby activating them, recruiting them, or restoring their strength is very important. Here we are targeting the multifidus transfers and rectus abdominis and obliques, also pelvic floor muscles to some extent. So digging into this topic further, this is the most commonly asked, or this is the most common dilemma every therapist or a few consultants might have, is the kind of rationale used behind giving a certain exercises in PIVD. Which biased exercises should be given? Should it be flexion biased or should it be extension biased? The principle here is very simple and basic. The pathology behind PIVD is displacement of disc material within its space, and the cause is excessive spinal flexion or anterior spinal loading. Any particular force or any particular activity which will increase the spinal loading is going to be bad, or it might just further deform the tissues. So we either maintain the spine in a neutral spine by just giving isometrics or just core activation or maintaining the tilts, or we give extension biased exercises which might help in reducing this anterior shear force, and thereby also will help in containing the disc material in within the space. It may not prevent the disc further getting deformed, but it might help in containing it back. In the similar fashion, if we look at canal stenosis, which is narrowing of the canal or its content in the posterior direction, excessive spinal extension or excessive lumbar lordosis may increase the posterior stress on the foramen nerves and also can cause to neural compromise. So should we add an extension force or a posterior shear force by giving extension bias? No, that doesn't really help much. So again, we will either go for neutral spine exercises or flexion biased exercises, which might help in relieving this pressure on the neural foramen. They could be a term. There are different terms to these exercises. They are either foraminal opening exercises or decompression exercises or flexion biased exercises. The goal purpose here is the same: to decrease the posterior stress on the foramen. And the next clinical parameter which clinically we see is muscle inefficiency. Muscle inefficiency could be because of muscles being hyperactive, that is tight muscles, or underactive or weak muscles. So tight muscles around the spine, it could be hip flexors, which might give rise to lower cross syndrome, or in the upper back could give rise to upper cross syndrome. So stretching them or inhibiting these muscles by different muscle release techniques or stretching techniques or using adjuncts like kinesiotaping, where we can inhibit them, can be helpful. And in weaker or underactive muscles, basically they reduce their stabilizing effect when we are talking about core muscles especially. So restoring or recruiting the core muscles is going to be the main goal here. And muscle recruitment techniques are we can focus on the core activation techniques by strengthening them and facilitatory techniques by using adjuncts like kinesiotaping, where we are facilitating them from its origin to its insertion. So this is also one of the adjuncts are also one of the ways to strengthen or inhibit muscles. We were I'll be further talking about McKenzie method, which helps in assessing, diagnosing, and also provides effective treatment for spinal disorders. This method was introduced in 1981 by Robin McKenzie, a physical therapist from New Zealand. So MDT, also called as McKenzie Differential Treatment or Diagnosis Treatment. I forgot to mention about neural mobilization when it comes to radicular symptoms associated with PIVD or lumbar canal stenosis. We also, in conservative management, provide sequential sliding or gliding nerves through their tissue interfaces with different movements across the spine. And thereby, it is proven, or there is enough evidence associated with it, that there could be reduction in radicular symptoms when we are giving neural mobilization. Moving on to McKenzie again. McKenzie highlights that thorough assessment is very important. Once you have assessed the movement patterns, which are painful, which are not, flexion, lateral flexion, extension, rotations, you go on to the classification. McKenzie provides a classification of syndromes based on the assessment. Once you've classified, you've diagnosed this a particular syndrome, you go on to the treatment options provided by McKenzie concept. And also, while you're approaching the treatment, you also explain the importance of prevention and how the issue won't be recurring again and again. McKenzie classification provides three syndromes: postural dysfunction and derangement. Postural is basically any end range stress on a normal structure. It could be muscles, tendons, joint surfaces. Because of prolonged sustained postures can cause pain, which may be local and reproducible when end range positions are sustained for a longer time. So the treatment options here would be postural correction, where we are restoring lumbar lordosis. We are basically trying to avoid tensile stress on the spine. The next syndrome under the classification is dysfunction. It implies adaptive shortening, scarring, or adherence of connective tissue. So there is consistent pain and movement loss. Pain is felt at end range movement. So the treatment options for this is mobilize the joint through different movement exercises in the direction of dysfunction. Goal here is to remodel the tissue within the limits of pain. Do repeated movements so that the tissue is finally remodeled or accustomed to the painful activity, and thereby the pain might abolish. And finally, the third most important, which is the derangement syndrome, which is the commonest, wherein there is anatomical disruption and displacement within the motion segments, like Sir explained about PIVD and canal stenosis. Herein, the certain movement patterns cause severe pain. It could be flexion, it could be extension, it could be lateral flexion, rotations, anything. So you look at these movement patterns and likewise start working on the treatment. The goal of McKenzie concept is to centralize pain or move the pain from leg to low back and eventually abolish it. So further discussing the last classification, which is the derangement part. Derangement could be reducible derangement and it could be irreducible derangement. Reducible derangement can be targeted in two, as in the physiotherapy part, could be targeted in two different treatment options. which could be either direct giving exercises in the direction of painful movement, wherein we are trying to remodel the tissues which are deformed, and with repeated movements, making it accustomed to the painful activities, and eventually the pain goes away because the tissue has become flexible in the painful movement direction. Or you train the tissues in the direction of opposite movement, wherein you start, the goal here is to centralize pain from its distal segment to the lower back, and eventually when it centralizes to the back region, you treat the back symptoms and abolish it. So this is about reducible derangement. Irreducible derangement is when there are permanent changes. There is not much scope for physiotherapy or conservative management in this, wherein it does require surgical intervention, or the physiotherapy scope would be limited to just maintaining the available range of motion, or just to maintain the muscles or tissues around it. Sort of prevent further derangement. But surgical intervention is the only option in irreducible derangement. So this is how we progress on with McKenzie. This is a very small representation of the actual bigger treatment. You start with prone. Let's just assume that this particular patient has pain and flexion biased activities. So we take the patient in from prone to the extension biased movement. You start loading the disc, or you start increasing the fluid of the disc material by just putting the patient in the prone position. It starts gradually providing nutrition around the disc space, and you start loading the patient in the opposite direction, and eventually come to a position or movement wherein there is a relief, and we are providing lesser posterior lesser stress on the anterior elements of the spine. So this is just one component of McKenzie, just to represent or a sort of give a pictorial representation of how it goes. The concept is very big, and there are a lot of treatment options to consider in this concept. So I hope that all the conservative management options have been discussed in this particular slide. And with this, I end with my today's topic of conservative management. And with this, I hand over the screen to Dr. Jayashree. She will be Dr. Jayashree and Dr. Manisha will be discussing the post-surgical rehabilitation associated with the disc herniation and stenosis. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Purva, for sharing your views on conservative management. Am I audible?
Yes, Dr. Jayashree, you are audible. Please share your screen.
Yeah. I'm Dr. Jayashree Somkusle, working as a senior physiotherapist in inpatient department, Sancheti Hospital, Pune. For sharing my topic, post-surgical rehabilitation phase one exercises. Coming to the key points of rehabilitation. Rehabilitation should begin immediately post-operative day one, and it may extend up to 3 to 4 months. Now, how long it should extend? It depends upon various factors like type of surgery the patient had, whether it is a decompression or microdiscectomy or fusion, then muscle strength, flexibility, balance, and coordination, other issues. Exercises helps that is necessary to required to that is necessary to require the that is necessary to build up strength and coordination during healing process. Workplace analysis and modifications made into that, along with the specially designed exercise protocol, also helps to return the work and maintain and to remain the work at long term. I'm sharing one article which is showing the impact of various postures on intradiscal pressure, where compared to the upright standing position, the intradiscal pressure reduces in reclining position by 50 to 80%, while slump sitting increases intradiscal pressure by 100%, and lifting object in forward lean standing, this one, and the last one, that is the forward lean sitting, increases 100 to 175%. Now, onto the basis of this, what precautions the patient should take after surgery, that we will discuss. The first, educating patient on proper body mechanics during activities of daily living. For example, in sleeping position, the patient should keep pillow under the knees in supine lying and pillow between the knees in side lying position. This next is a lifting technique. So while lifting an object off the floor, one should bend at the knee and not at the waist. That is, the squat lift is preferred over stoop lift. This is why, because it reduces the intradiscal pressure, and also we recommend patient to carry object close to the body so that it also helps to reduce the intradiscal pressure. Next important position is the sitting. In sitting, we recommend use straight back. In this, or lumbar roll of about 2, and the hip should lie at the knee level. Feet should be supported on the floor. This position should be adopted for sitting. So this is about the positions that need instead use log roll. Doing log roll technique, we ask them at the same time pushing on the arms, we ask them to sit up. So this actually prevents the twisting movement in a spine. No lifting, pushing or pulling of objects over 4 pounds for a period of 2 weeks. Then avoid low or soft cushion chair, as this surfaces offers a very little support. Next, use raised toilet seat, commode chair, grab bars in and non-slippery mat. Coming to the phase one protocol, which starts from the post-operative day one and lasts up to week four. Post-operatively, pain is expected to decrease gradually over a period of 6 to 8 weeks. However, this lumbosacral corset, which protects the incisional site from mechanical stress, along with this conventional tens, that is transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation, also assists with the pain relief and the control basic pain. Next, teaching the patient to how to get in and out of the bed. Third, gentle exercises we start. For example, initiating ankle pumps in supine lying, gluteus and quadriceps sets, heel slides, then supine lying hip adduction, abduction. And the most important is position. That is, for this, we teach the patient to abdominal drawing in manual. In this, we ask them to breathe in and breathe out. While breathe out, tell them to contract the abdominals and hold for 10 seconds. There is one article I'm sharing, which is a recent article, and it shows this article has compared the effect of abdominal drawing in lumbar stabilization exercise with and without respiratory resistance. Abdominal drawing in manual decreases the lordosis through abdominal hollowing and induces the contraction of diaphragm and transversus abdominis, which contribute to lumbar stabilization. Early mobilization. Most of the patient ambulate are allowed to ambulate on. Assisted device can be used for ambulation. It also depends on the other factor, the flexible muscle strength and the balance issues. Then postoperatively on day 3 and or day 4, we allow patient to sit for all meals, but not more than 10 to 15 minutes at a stretch. Should leave the hospital within they begin their outpatient physiotherapy management. So this is all about the post-operative phase 1 protocol. I'd like to hand over Dr. Manisha for the next phase 2 protocol.
Thank you, Dr. Jayashree, for your input. Now I would further share my screen. And here I would let you know about what could be the exercises and the protocol which will be followed in the phase 2. That is in the second month and the third month. Here, when we start from the fourth week to the eighth week, here we start with stretching exercises, which will focus on lower stability exercises, because after surgery, we do have weakness. All the muscles of the core and other pelvic floor muscles are weak, so we need to have strengthening for that. Neural mobilization, impact aerobic conditioning, that is walking or recumbent bike, that is up to 30 minutes per day. The sitting activities can be increased, walking activities can be increased. Here, when I come to stretching, very important is hamstring stretching and quadriceps stretching. Nerve root is located to prevent the formation of adhesions or scarring of the nerve. Stretching also helps to manage pain and also reduces opioid medications. Any surgical repairs or replacements made during the surgery must heal properly. For this, stretching is an important factor. When I have stretching exercises, the piriformis muscle stretching, which is done in this posture, with the low back muscle, knee to hamstring stretching, which is done in supine lying position, and quadriceps stretching, which can be done in standing. These all stretches help further to maintain the flexibility of the muscle. When I move ahead, I come up to core stability. Ability to stabilize, I mean, is the ability to control the motion and control the movement of the core. That is, in short, core stability, which is to be acquired post-surgery, very important. Your muscles, which are important, which we work on here, abdominis, multifidus, and rectus abdominis muscle. In the first phase, we already check transverse abdominis as Dr. Jayashree said, but here we need to go little higher. Like we need to progress from simple exercises to second phase. So here, when we go up to core stabilization exercises, major exercises is to start with abdominal curls, basic ones, just for the neck and shoulder lifting. Second, bridging, where you will be contracting your core, your glute muscles, and then lift your waist from the bed. Third, we start with the straight leg raise, which will be focusing on your quadriceps muscle. Next, when we move on to cat and camel, I like to explain. This is a good tendon mobilization for the spine, which is allowed in phase two. Now it works on strengthening and stretching of core muscles. Here in the picture, when you see, your starting position will be neutral. This is the first position when you take it as a cat. In that, neck will forward, and then this is a camel part. So in the first one, cat exercise and camel exercise, this we have to hold on for 5 seconds and then relax. This is to be done 10 times. Next, when we include, here also we can start with aerobic conditioning, which is walking on a treadmill and bicycle, as I discussed further. Walking should be, treadmill can be started from 10 minutes and then extended up to 15 to 17 minutes. Further, we move on to from week 9 to 12. Here we will add advanced core and multiplanar exercises, which will be little for the core muscles and the lower back muscles. Also, we will add advanced aerobic conditioning, where we will add, now we can use elliptical machine. Gradually, and resume to work program if you are indicated. So, see the phase three, that is from week 9 to 12. I'm sorry for the interruption. So here we were looking at advanced core and multiplanar exercises, advanced aerobic conditioning. Gradually we can resume to our ADLs and return to work and program if indicated. Here planks, when we see planks in beginners can be started with 5 seconds. Here we have to always perform planks and Superman exercise according to the pain tolerance. The Superman is a perfect equipment free way. It works on your obliques, your lower back, and helps you improve your flexibility in erector spinae. So this is a plank exercise which is advanced. Now we move on to another advanced activity that we have in the phase three, are the gym ball exercises. Here, what are the benefits of gym ball?
Dr. Manisha, we are facing some time constraints. So can you just quickly summarize the last phase without sharing the screen space?
Summarize it.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, I'll do that, no problem. Was speaking about the benefits of gym ball, where there is strengthening the core, stabilizing the body, it improves balance and maintains good posture, helps to prevent further injuries.
Dr. Manisha, we are able to hear you properly.
Stabilization of the core. Yeah. So I was just summarizing the last part, which is the gym ball exercises. Strengthening the core, stabilizing the body. This also helps to have a good posture, have good balance, which many people have issues in in after, we'll be improving the motion and also prevents further injuries. So all these exercises help in stabilizing the core. So that was all which I would like to add to phase three. And I would give the over to Dr. Purva.
Thank you, Dr. Manisha. I'd like to thank Dr. Jayashree and Manisha for sharing their views and thoughts on post-surgical rehabilitation in lumbar surgeries. So let's move on to our last and next segment, which is going to be the question and answer segment. This will be directed to Dr. Siddharth Iyer. Hello, sir. Welcome back. Sir, we have some questions from patients, some physical therapists, and some concerning consultants. So we just quickly, we gathered some four questions which would be suitable in with the time constraints we are having today. So let's begin with the first question, sir. So what is your opinion on usage of braces right after any lumbar surgery? Should they be using an assistive device like braces to help them support or post surgeries?
Yeah. Right. So I think we need to know a little more about what is the time. If the surgery is a minimal access surgery, number one, and if it's a only decompression surgery where you're not electively doing a fusion, this is very optional according to me. There is no proven literature that a braced microdiscectomy patient does better than the other. Maybe the patient does feel more comfortable when he is wearing a corset. Additionally, it just keeps the patient aware that he's just had a low back, you know, unaccustomed movement otherwise he would have performed. In terms of the sheer needing for bracing, yes, sometimes we do brace patients for major surgeries where you're actually not just done a decompression, but you have put in instruments and you have put in implants and you're hope.
So your voice is breaking.
Protective device. But frankly, for just decompression, I hope I'm clear.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, thank you for clearing our doubt with the first question. Moving on to the second question, sir. It's again a question from rehabilitation point of view. How early, what is your opinion regarding how early should a patient start bending or start flexion-based activities post any lumbar surgery?
So I agree with, you know, what plan Jayashree had enumerated in her talk. So generally for the first 3 to 4 weeks, we do ask the patients to avoid any flexion-based activities, more so especially with fusions rather than decompressions. But if the patient has had a minimal access lumbar decompression or a discectomy, then quite often by 3 weeks, they are comfortable enough to at least do basic bending forward. It might not be any loaded bending, like, you know, no, obviously lifting weights, but then, you know, bending at the knee. Those are some of the tricks. You saw those cartoon animations that Jayashree had, you know, if the patient is able to bend his knee and hip and flex the hip and knee enough, then he can cover a lot of that distance that has to come between the ground and the patient. And, you know, that type of bending is very the surgical procedure. But yes, loaded bending, when you're bending to lift weights, bending to lift heavy objects, I think those would be better suited to be avoided, at least in the first force you get into the advanced stage, the phase of strengthening. And if my patient has been regular with the post, you know, the phase two strengthening programs, then maybe at 3 months, I would offer all patients to resume all previous activities, I mean, that they were doing before the surgery also. So much to say that they can reach their pre-morbid status. You know, so before they had a morbidity, what all they were doing, which is age, based on what is suitable for that age, we will allow. Not a problem.
Thank you, sir. This has clarified my personal doubt here. So the next question is from surgical point of view. So based on physical and radiological findings, how does an orthopedic surgeon decide which procedure to go for? Has it to be a laminectomy or microdiscectomy?
Is considered to be the gold standard in terms of the surgical procedure. For laminectomy, it was done wider decompression or a larger bony window is made, but then for just a disc prolapse, honestly, there is no need to do an entire laminectomy. You can quite alone, situation is enough to reach that disc fragment, you know, and remove it, because the main offending culprit there is the fragment. There's not so much of degenerative lumbar canal stenosis. Then I think off late, what we've realized is people are going in for more minimal invasive surgery. So skin incisions are smaller, collateral damage or how much dissection you do, how much you traumatize the muscle, the skin, the subcutaneous tissue. The collateral damage in the process to reach that offending fragment, that has changed. So you have percutaneous procedures like endoscopic discectomies. You have tubular dilators, which don't actually, you don't have to dissect muscle. It just serially dilates the tubes and the muscles are just spread apart and, you know, they split and spread apart. So the mechanical trauma that the muscle or the paraspinal musculature endures is much lower. So in that sense, I think microdiscectomy is still the standard, and there are obviously newer techniques that are helping early rehab, quicker recovery, shorter hospital stay, lower blood loss, all for the advantage of the patient.
Thank you, sir. So the next and the last question is a case-related question. Supposedly a 125 kg obese patient walks into an OPD with an acute PIVD with no neurological symptoms. What would be the line of management? Would it be surgical or would it be conservatively managed according to you, sir?
So generally, if you look at acute PIVD, I think for considering surgery, offer surgery, then generally it is only for significant neurological deficit or cauda equina syndrome. All other disc prolapses can be tried at least on a conservative, you know, tailor the treatment to offer surgery at a later date. But generally, broadly speaking, conservative trial can be tried. In the OBs, there are two issues. Precedence that it causes higher amount of mechanical back pain. Sometimes even disc extrusions are seen to be more common in OBs. But it's not a blanket statement who come with acute disc prolapses. So it's not the only factor. But yes, out of, say, multifactorial 10 causations, maybe obesity does have play a role. Of symptoms, whether he has had some conservative trial, whether he has failed the conservative trial, whether he has deficit. So your particular question, when the patient comes without deficit, I think you can wait and see how he responds. Quite often 2 to 3 weeks is a fair enough wait time to wait. If his pain is severe, you can give him a nerve root block to help him with therapy. Still wait for 3 weeks and then take a call on the surgical management for such a patient.
Thank you, sir, for answering all these questions today. So with this last segment, we have come to the end of this panel discussion today. And I'd like to now talk about the vote of thanks.
Thank you so much for having me here. It was a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me here. It was a pleasure speaking. And great job, Ian Manisha, for clearing up the post-operative protocols and the conservative management options in lumbar disc herniations.
Thank you, sir. It's our honor. I like to thank. So now I like to thank Dr. Siddharth Iyer for sharing his views and thoughts on disc herniations and lumbar canal stenosis, providing insightful information on various surgical approaches. Thank you, sir. Further, I'd like to thank Dr. Neeraj Athawale and Head of Department Dr. Supriya Kondal, Physiotherapy, for their valuable input and technical assistance. Lastly, I'd like to thank Sancheti Hospital for giving this opportunity and platform for today's panel discussion. I hope that this discussion has been informative, helpful, and insightful to all our viewers out there. Thank you.